Hello everyone and welcome to this new technical video. Today we will tackle a topic that we often hear about, especially if you watch more sports, maybe in the commentaries, and that many of you probably already know, but not everyone actually knows how to use it. Today I will talk about the load transfer. What is the load transfer? I'm going to explain you right away. All the things that I will say in this first part of the video apply to both cars and motorbikes, and applies to both driving on the track and driving on the road. But it also applies on the driving simulators, because they simulate exactly what the real car does. So if you have the steering wheel and the pedals and play the simulator, this video is for you. Then, in the second part of the video, I will make a distinction and I will talk about cars and motorcycles, and I will explain how to use it in both situations. So the physical phenomena that you will see in this video, I already talked about them in the video where I explain why the front brake is stronger than the rear brake. So here, I will just recap them. If you don't understand something, please go watch the other video, which I link below, to understand better what I'm talking about. So when a motorcycle or car goes at any speed, the physical principle of inertia applies, meaning that a body that is in a state of rest, still, or in a state of uniform motion, so which is going straight, maintains its state. And what does it mean? It means that if the car or motorcycle is still, it remains still, while if it's going at 100 and you release the throttle, it wants to remain at 100. So due to the principle of inertia, when there's a body that moves and you want it to slow down, this opposes resistance to the slowdown. Likewise, when there is a body that moves or is still, and you want to accelerate it, it resists to the acceleration. So if we take our vehicle that is going straight at like 100, when we brake, it is as if we applied a force to the ground that pulls our vehicle backwards. The force is applied to the ground because what's really slowing us down is the friction between the tire and the asphalt. As I said, however, the vehicle opposes to the braking due to the inertia. And this inertia is like a force applied to the center of gravity of the bike, which pushes toward the opposite direction of the brake. Since these two forces are not at the same level, but they are at different levels, the vehicle will tend to flip forward. But this flip does not happen because it is damped by the front suspensions. So it happens that when you brake, the front suspensions are compressed and the rear suspensions are released. So during braking, the front suspensions are much more loaded than the rear suspensions, which are, in fact, unloaded. So, the so-called load transfer occurs. When you brake, the car load moves to the front, compressing the front wheels on the ground. On the other hand, when we accelerate, the exact opposite happens. We have a load transfer on the rear. So, the rear suspensions are compressed, while the front suspensions are released. Now, the bike are a little bit bitches because at the base of their functioning they have a very complex physical phenomenon. One example, when the motorbike accelerates, we have a load transfer to the rear. So the rear suspension tends to compress, but it actually extends. Say, why is it happening? So it is a very complex phenomenon that maybe if you want to hear about it, I will make a dedicated video about that. But basically it's because when you accelerate, the chain pulls the rear wheel to the front and this force wants to extend the suspension. So it's very tricky. But anyway, the load transfer occurs anyway. So let's go back to the load transfer. Now that we know what it is, how do we use it? Let's start with the cars. What I always say when I teach someone the basics of driving on track, I always say the following. The turns in the car are not made with the steering wheel, but they are made with the brakes. So what does that mean? I'll explain you now. When we brake, as I mentioned before, the load is transferred to the front. So the front tires are much more loaded and much more pressed to the ground. Now, as I explained in the video about the front brakes, the more the tire is pressed to the ground, the more grip it has. So if we start to turn the steering wheel while the car is still braking, the car has much more grip on the front, so it can turn more. The car can enter the turn much faster. In the other hand, if we release the brake and then we start to turn, the front wheels are unloaded, so they have less grip, and the car tends to go wide and struggles to turn. So the drivers, to go fast, they tend to bring the braking until the apex of the corner, to make sure that they load the front tires and corner better and faster. So that's easy, isn't it? Not exactly, actually. Because if we brake too hard while steering, we are loading the front tires too much. And like everything in the world, they have a limit. And if you go over that limit, we lock the front tires and we lose any kind of braking power and directional power. So if we exaggerate the braking and steering and we lock the front tires, the car does not want to brake anymore and we go straight, wide, and eventually into the wall.
But when it comes to the braking, he can't make it happen. Both tires.
One other thing is that we focused on the front, but we didn't think about the rear. So when we brake, if the front loads, the rear unloads, so the rear loses grip. So it happens that if we exaggerate the braking into the curves, the front is loaded and has a lot of grip. The rear is unloaded and has low grip. So we end up spinning. So the skill of the racing drivers lies in finding the right limit in braking into the corner without braking too much and locking the front tires, and without braking too much and making the car spinning. This is all about experience, feeling, sensibility.
For example, in this video you can see the worst crash that I ever had on a race car. It was my first racing season, I was very inexperienced, and that's a bad mistake. I had new tires in the front and used tires on the rear, so I have much more grip in the front than the rear. So as soon as I entered the corner, I lost the rear and the car started to oversteer. At that point, I made a mistake. Instead of accelerating and bringing the load on the rear, I started to brake. This worsened the situation because it moved more load to the front, increasing the oversteer. That led the car to oversteer more, and eventually it rolled over and I destroyed the car. And that was a very bad crash that had no consequences because I was on the track, but if it happened on the road, I could have probably died. This makes you understand how important it is to know the load transfer, because by knowing how the load transfer works, this accident could have been avoided.
So now what happens when we accelerate? When we accelerate, we have a weight transfer on the rear, so the rear has more grip. And this is particularly useful when we are entering some very fast corners, where we feel the car that wants to oversteer a little bit. And it's not good to lose the rear at 200 km per hour. So if we feel the car unstable in very fast corner, if we touch the accelerator before entering the corner, we give the car stability. Because we put load on the rear, we give more grip on the rear tires, and the car doesn't want to oversteer anymore. On the opposite, if we feel that in these fast corners, the car doesn't want to turn and wants to go straight, we can release the throttle in order to provide a load transfer to the front. Because if we release the throttle, the car is slowed down by the friction of the air, friction of the ground, and the engine brake. So it's like if we are braking a little bit. Or we can even touch the brake a little bit to transfer the load on the front and allow the car to steer. And what about the road? On road, the key word is safety. We're not looking for the limit, we're not looking for doing the corners as fast as possible. We're just looking for safe driving. We try to reach our destination alive. And what they taught us at driving school is do not brake while turning. And is it true? Actually, sometimes I slam on the brake in the middle of the corner, because maybe there is a sudden red light, a car stop, a danger, but I can do it because I'm very experienced from the track, so I know how to control the car. Instead, those who have very little experience of sport driving, they risk to kill themselves. Why? For the reason that I just explained. If you are turning and slam on the brake, you either lock the front tires and go straight, but with the ABS it's almost impossible. Or, more likely, you unload the rear and load the front and spin. And even if you have the ESP, it has limits. It cannot save you from everything. And often happens, maybe in the highways, maybe with the wet ground, maybe with the used tires, that people realize that, oh my god, I'm going too fast, let's brake. And they brake while turning, and they end up spinning, and they crash. So, paradoxically, what is the best thing to do in these situations? In these situations, the best thing to do is accelerating a little bit. Because if you accelerate, as I mentioned before, you move the load to the rear, and you give more stability to the rear. Actually, if you just accelerate to keep the constant speed, you're applying 50% load on the rear and 50% load on the front. And you are giving the car the maximum possible stability. So in the road, for example, in the highways, if you have a very long corner and you somehow need to slow down, it's much better to slow down before the corner and then keep constant throttle into the corner. But emergencies happen. So what do we do if we find ourselves into a long corner where we realize that we entered a little bit too fast and we want to slow down a little bit? I'm not talking about stopping the car, I'm talking about just slowing down a little bit. The best thing to do is to just release the accelerator. Because two things happen. When you release the throttle, the car actually starts to slow down due to the engine brake and the friction with the air. So by slowing down, some load is transferred to the front and the car is actually steering more than when you accelerate. Very often, by simply slowing down, we solve every problem. Instead, if we really enter too fast and we say, oh my god, I'm going off track, I'm fucked, in that case you have to brake. But the most important thing to do is to not do this, boom, not to slam on the brake immediately, but to be a little bit more gentle, because this way you allow the load to transfer to the front slowlier and make the car more stable. But in any case, give it a try. Try to find a safe road with long corners and try to approach those corners with a bit of gas, constant speed, and with no gas. You will feel that when you release the gas, the car immediately turns much more. Okay, good, and what about the motorcycles? Basically, the same things apply to motorbikes, even if there are some more complex dynamics. For example, when we are accelerating on braking, the bike becomes shorter or longer because of its geometry. It's crazy, but when you're riding, the bike never has the same length. For instance, to make the corners, you have to lean. And when you lean, the suspensions are compressed. And when they are compressed, the bike becomes longer and more stable. So it's not just the load transfer that regulates how the bike works, but it's a mix of weight transfers and another phenomena. However, more or less, the basics are the same. As I explained in one old video from 2017, which if you don't remember, you can watch. I linked it in the description. It's in Italian, but with English titles. When riding on track, if you enter the corner by braking a little, the front wheel is more loaded, so it has more grip, so it turns better. But exactly like in the car, we must not exaggerate. Because if we brake too hard when leaning, you know what happens. And one thing that I found very useful on motorcycles is about the acceleration. I analyzed the telemetry of a friend of mine, a world championship rider, and I saw that just before accelerating to exit the corner, he opens the gas a little bit, like 5%, and then he accelerates. He does something like, why is that? Because by opening the gas just a little bit, he transfers some load to the rear tire, he presses it, giving to it more grip, so that when he actually starts to accelerate, the tire is already loaded and has more grip. So there is less risk to lose the rear and have an eyesight. And I can say that this worked for any kind of motorbike. I found it very useful also with the pit bikes, where instead of whoa, accelerating immediately and loses the rear and crashing like here, if you just boo, open the throttle a little bit to load the tire and then full gas, you don't crash. Finally, the load transfer explains why all the most powerful cars are rear-wheel drive. Because when you accelerate, the load moves back, so the front wheels are lightened and the rear wheels are pressed. And if the traction is on the front and we have too many horsepower, we don't have enough grip on the front to take advantage of the horsepowers. While being the rear wheel loaded, we have more grip and we are able to use all the horsepower of the car. So guys, this is the end for this video. I hope you liked it. I hope you were able to learn something new. And if you did, please subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Bye bye.